stand with us as we sing?
I'm going to read a psalm.
Psalm 100 says, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness and come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." I asked a member at Faith Reform just a little while ago, says, "How old is this church?" It says, 1954. Apparently, Ron, you had a difference of opinion on that. But it's been 68 years. So the psalm talks about the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. And that is marked by every family here. Some of you I was a young person with, a teenager, went through school, did various events, and all those decades have passed, and we see the faithfulness of the Lord as it goes on to this day. He's faithful to this church. We see another generation coming up. We see the faithfulness of the Lord continue. So we're going to keep that as a centerpiece, and Jesus Christ is center. So the centerpiece here this morning, we're not here to check off a box. We're not to say that we went to church. We're here to say that Jesus Christ is front and center, and we just sang about his amazing grace. That's what it's all about, his amazing grace. So we're going to pray this morning. I'm going to make a few announcements, and then we're going to continue. So let's pray together. Father, we do thank you for your amazing grace. We could have never planned a plan of salvation like you did. It is unique. It is wonderful. It is comprehensive, and it was painful for you. But it is eternal life for us. So we thank you for that. We pray that the songs that we would sing and the words that are spoken would bring glory and honor to the one who saved us, and that it would be for your glory to build you up, and that we would be blessed through the whole process. In your name we pray. Amen. A few housekeeping things. For those of you at Faith Reform, there's going to be a congregational meeting next Sunday after the service. And we got some business to attend to. Regarding the Bryce Creek gathering that's coming up on July 9th, Victory has been gracious enough. I think they haven't told me, I think they're gonna have steak there just for us. And he's fine, so you can eat all you want. No, they're gonna provide the main course, and Faith Reform is gonna bring dessert. So if you're gonna bring some food, Faith Reform people bring dessert, they'll take care of the rest of that.
Because you're bringing pie.
We're going to have an open house. We have Ron and Jan Vanderwerf are very kind. Next week, a previous pastor, Paul and Courtney Van Mayen, are going to meet in town, and they would like to have an avenue where those of you that are friends with them can meet. So at 3 p.m., a week from today, the Vanderwerf's house, they're going to have kind of an open house, and you can come there and you can get reacquainted with the Van Mayen family. And Adam is going to be available after the service, kind of a meet and greet. You can get to meet him and see what this is like. But I will say, I sure do like that worship team. You guys are very into it just fine. So let's continue on in our worship.
Morning, church.
Morning.
Yeah, so you might see a few new faces around here every now and again. We're the Yuns. We are related. If you couldn't tell, I'm their dad. I'm not a kid, right? Even though they're catching me in height. Yeah, what an awesome blessing it is for us to be able to come here and worship with you guys. So today is Father's Day, so I want to say Happy Father's Day to all the dads out there. As I was having my quiet time this morning, I'm like, well, what do we give our Father God on Father's Day? Right? Like, I know that for me, all my kids are different, and I don't all have gift givers, so I'm not expecting gifts from all of my kids. But I know that there are gift givers. I do have a kid who is a very strong gift giver. I have kids who like doing things and making things for me. I have kids who like to talk nonstop. And that's just their way of bonding and appreciating me. And I appreciate my time with my kids. And I think that God has given us all the tools. He doesn't need anything from us, right? But it's good when we shift our focus off of ourselves and the things that are going on around us, and we turn that focus on Him, and we give glory and praise and honor to Him because He's so worthy. And so how awesome is it that we get to be in church on Father's Day? We may not have all had the best earthly father, but we have a great heavenly Father who loves us so deeply. So I just want to encourage you guys as we sing and as we hear the preaching of the word, because all of life is worship, that you will respond to your heavenly Father this morning and give Him the gifts and praise that He deserves. So we're going to sing a song called Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. There's a line in the song that says, "Here I raise my Ebenezer." And I love the story of David, who, you all know the story of David. And he just went through so many battles and trials in his life. But he was a man after God's own heart. And there's a part in the story where he raises an Ebenezer, which is like a monument. And at that Ebenezer, he remembered what God had done. And so as I look upon my life and I remember what God has done for me, crazy last couple of years in our family, I went through 2 brain surgeries. I lost a friend this last week, but God is still good and God still deserves our praise and our worship. And I don't know where you guys have been or where you're at, but there's always a place where you can worship God. And definitely when you're struggling, it's probably the best times to reach out to your Father and He will meet you. And I know that your church has been through a lot, but remember the good things that God has done up to this point, and God is leading you if you are faithful and obedient to what He has called you to do. This is just a part of the journey. There's still way more to go, guys. So let's stand and let's worship.
Mercy never ceasing, call for us, God. You are a way maker, a miracle worker, promise keeper.
Intercede for us, that you came and you died for us, that you paid it all. Thank you that you rose from the grave and that you gave us your Holy Spirit. And we ask that your Holy Spirit continue to move through this place this morning. Soften our hearts for the preaching of the word. And I pray, Lord, that you continue to do what you're doing in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name's Adam. In a second, we're going to have this mission team come forward for commissioning. But before that, I just want to bring my family up here so you can see this lovely family. You can just be on this, just so they can see you. This is my wife, Danielle. We've been married for 18 years. This is my oldest daughter, Eliana. She is 15. This is my tallest daughter, Eden. She is 14. This is my third daughter, Ebony. She's 12. And this is my one and only son, Zion, and he's 10. So, you guys say hi to them?
Hi.
We're really excited to worship with you guys this morning, and I'm pretty excited that we get to come on a special weekend where the mission team is going to be commissioned. So I'll invite Curtis up. I'm learning names. Grace, Lord. And I'll pass it to you.
Yeah, and while I'm speaking, I'll invite the team to come forward. And if we have a picture of the rest of the team, we can throw that up. So in your bulletins, there is a little handout to be praying for the mission team, all of us by name. Sure, go on the stairs. Okay, all on the stairs. So we have kind of a combined team of some people from this church and some people from Sunlight Church, and then a couple from other ones as well. We couldn't quite get everybody in a picture with having somebody else able to take the picture. So there's most of us. The other half of us is at Sunlight being commissioned there. So yeah, you can take this, be praying for us. This is in your bulletin. There's our itinerary. One thing that Dorothy so kindly pointed out to me is that it says we leave Wednesday, July 21. We're leaving June 21. And we're not going to be there for a year and come back the following June. So, our theme is on the back of it. It's Highlands and the verse in the back of it. So you can be reading through that and praying through that with us as well as we try to grow and serve others. We're going down to Guadalajara and Puerto Vallarta, Mexico to serve with the Emmanuel Foundation. It's been a long-standing orphanage type thing, taking kids and off of the street or from abusive situations. A lot of times their dads are, who knows, and their moms are in prison. And they care for the kids, send them to school, feed them, clothe them, teach them about God's love. And then they also do prison ministry and outreach ministry and have a neighborhood church, and they have a food bank there for that. They bring the kids to the prison to see their parents when they go and support the churches in the prison. So we'll get to come alongside them with all of those things. Hopefully going to a prison in Mexico, putting on VBS for the kids, doing work projects around the facilities there, and anything else? Playing, having fun, trying out our Spanish, yeah? All right, and soccer. We're gonna play a lot of soccer down there. Yeah, we'll help out with the church and passing out food. So we're excited for that. Thank you for supporting us, for sending us down. And really, this is all of us as are being the hands and feet of God, that you guys are a part of this, and you're sending us down to work, do work in Jesus' name on behalf of this whole church. So thank you for doing that. Thank you for sending us out and praying for us. And now I'll turn it over and Adam pray.
Well, I want to pray over them, but any of you that want to, you guys could like go down to the main floor. Any of you that want to come up and lay hands on them, send them out in prayer. These trips, it feels like we're going to go serve the Lord in Mexico, but any of you who have done that, you know, like, this is about what God's doing in these folks, primarily. So they're going to be blessed in Mexico, but we're praying for God to do something in them. And I'm going to be praying from 2 Thessalonians. Father God, I want to first just thank you for the opportunity to go down to Mexico and to serve. God, I want to thank you for the yes in these folks' spirit. They want to know you. They want to serve you. And God, I want to pray that you would make them worthy of your calling and fulfill every resolve for good and every work of faith by your power, so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in them. God, I pray that according to the grace of our Lord, that they would be changed as they are down there. That they would come back and it would affect their lives as they go about their daily lives when they get back. God, thank you for the joy that they're going to experience down there. Thank you for the poverty that they're going to see while they're down there. Thank you for the team atmosphere that they're going to dive into while they're down there. And God, we pray that you be glorified and recognized through this team. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, before I have my daughter come up to read scripture, I do have a gift for Father's Day. So I'd like to invite my friends up here. You want to use your microphone? Are there any dads here? Any dads? Okay, this is for you guys. Any dad jokes? Who's going first?
Me.
All right.
I used to be addicted to the Hokey Pokey, but I turned myself around.
Yes.
That's what it's all about. Yeah, I just couldn't put my whole self in.
Nice. Very good.
So, I read that by law, you have to have your headlights on when it's raining in Sweden. But how am I supposed to know when it's raining in Sweden?
Very good. Good. Thank you. My gift to you guys. All right, would you like to come up and read the word for us? Thank you.
Ephesians 2:1-10. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. Among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive, together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with him, and seated with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and it is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them.
Thank you. Well, I'm going to start off with a little bit about me, and it really ties into this text, into the sermon. My story, I've kind of formulated my story as a creation, fall, redemption, restoration story. And the last few years, finishing up some schooling, I was going through some exercises, looking at my origins and critical moments and life themes and relationships and lessons learned. And I just became profoundly aware of the weight my family of origin has played in shaping my life. The impact of my paternal and maternal side has had on me is just tremendous. I've witnessed normal people with average talents have enormous impact. Maybe some of you guys have a story like that. And it was really driven home several years ago during a several year stretch where we were memorializing grandparents as they died. I witnessed people coming out of the woodworks. I grew up knowing I was loved. I knew that about them. I don't remember a time when that was absent of encouragement or investment by these grandparents. And at their memorial service, I was able to see many people come to honor their lives and impact. And these were old Young Life kids, old neighbors, old co-workers. And then during the receptions, there were story after story of being in a group with my grandparents, or being in a Bible study, or receiving notes, or a meal with prayer. And this was a vision that was embraced and practiced by my parents, by my aunts and uncles, a vision for loving Jesus and for reaching out to people. This was the environment where I received Christ as a young boy, and surrounded by extended family, my Uncle Jim and my Grandpa Dick baptized me in the Puget Sound, in the shadow of the Fox Island Bridge there. And I wanted that kind of life as I grew up, to have a life with love and with impact. So with that as my foundation, I can see how I was primed for a life to pursue my own faith and interactions with people. That's my creation story. And then we get to this fall part of my story. And as I experienced more freedom growing up, becoming a teenager, I started to love the things of the world, started to care more and more about image, and found identity in friends and what they thought of me. My life looked more and more just like everyone else's life at my school, but on the inside there was this struggle. I'm already wired as an introvert, and I tend to be more introspective, and as I developed this dualistic lifestyle, there was this struggle. I had a life where I was engaged in my local church youth group, in school with Young Life, but I also smoked a lot of weed that people didn't know about with my friends, and I had a filthy mouth that came from a mind that was getting more and more confused and deceived. You guys are like, what is he doing here? I found a way to walk that line, to not let those two lives collide. I didn't get caught or found out, but I was finding that I couldn't thrive as a bad kid with a conscience, and I couldn't really be a good kid and do these things. So I was a good kid doing bad things, but I wasn't thriving as a good kid. So graduating high school and moving away for college was a big moment for me, because I got to experience the freedom that came with distance. I could now drop the pretense of being a good kid or being a bad kid, and I could just pick and choose which one I wanted to be. And it was liberating not to have that duality in me, even though I was becoming more enslaved to shame. I knew that I was living the wrong way. I was becoming more enslaved to fear that if anyone really knew what I was like, no one would love me. I was becoming more enslaved to the flesh. I was not saying no to whatever I wanted. I was saying yes to what Adam wanted. And my desires were not coming from a healthy life. Here comes this redemption part of my story. Two passages came to mind as I reflected on the changes that God did in me in this certain season of life. Deuteronomy 7:7-8 says, "It was not because you were more in number than any other people that the Lord says love on you and shows you. For you are the fewest of all peoples, but it's because the Lord loves you." And he's keeping his oath that he swore to your fathers, that the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And then Ephesians 2 says, "You were dead in the trespasses and sins, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and we were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. God pursued me in my darkness of my mind, in pursuit of the false God that I had erected, which was the God of Adam," me, Adam. "The deposit that he had given me of the Holy Spirit was still there."
Amen.
"And I was finding that with Adam as Adam's God, I was not fulfilled. The shame and the fear were a heavy weight, and not being able to fully embrace the dark side was an equally heavy weight. I did evil, but I knew it was evil, and that's just an unbearable place to be. I sought out a local church, and through a course of events, I went on a mission trip, just like these kids are going on, down to Mexico. And on that trip, I had an honest moment with God. I encountered and embraced God's love. I remember feeling the disgust of my sin, feeling the full weight of my sin. I felt like I was kneeling before Jesus and I was ashamed and I didn't feel like I could lift my face to him. And then that verse that talks about God's kindness leading us to repentance was playing itself out in my life. It felt like Jesus was lifting my head and his love was overcoming my shame. I was able to see the offense and the pride of my life that I had been living and the duality and finding identity in other things. And I was shocked at the slide my life has taken. And I chose them and there to start over. And I've done that many times since. It was this restoration piece of my story. It was as I was finding life and fulfillment and being a child of God that some of the themes that God had used in my family started to take shape in my life. I found ministry in relationships, just like my grandparents had done. I was letting myself be mentored by older brother Christians, and I was pouring out into younger brothers. I met and married my wife, Danielle. We started a family. And I stand on the shoulders of my parents and aunts and uncles and grandparents. Danielle and I have created a similar lifestyle using our kids' relationships and using our own table to create community and an environment that is inclusive and intentional. I look back over that several year period where Adam was God. It was unfortunate that I chose to live like that, but I'm so thankful for the feeling that God allowed me to have of the offense of sin. The fear of how deceptive and easy a life of duality can be is certainly a reminder as I am pursuing my kids' discipleship. I have grace for things because I've received grace. I'm so thankful for the scriptures. They've taught me God's heart. I've learned how to repent from David. I've learned how to live on mission and community through the New Testament. Through seminary training and affirmation, through the ordination process and the prayers of the church, I now am doing pastoral ministry. It's a calling for me, a way to use my gifts, but I see how God orchestrated these events throughout my life to make me, to give me a foundation, to pursue me. I don't place more stock on what I do in the church than what I can do outside the church. I'm just thankful for these critical moments in life. These are paving stone moments, and they're stepping stones that I look back on. So I share all that so you can know a little bit more about me, but because my story gets played out every time I open up the text. As often as I reflect on my story, I'm reminded of the weakness of my mind and my flesh and how many times throughout my life story I have fallen. My wife says I talk about sin too much. But every time I remember my sin, I remember God's grace. I want to be an old man that is moved to tears when I talk about the grace of God. So I got to start crying now. I can't. Age will come. Ephesians 1:7 has been a remember verse for me. You guys have any remember verses? This remember verse for me says, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. Most Sundays I'm aware that I'm speaking to mostly a crowd of people that have been steeped in the Bible, and many of you can give an amazing testimony of God's salvation power at work in your life or around your life, and many of you have an acute remembrance of the trespasses and the sins that you have been susceptible to. This passage that we're going to look at today in Ephesians 2 reminds us of those powers that have been at work to drown us from the freedom of knowing, experientially knowing, not just in your mind, but in your heart, knowing the goodness and the joy of Christ. It reminds us of the grace of God to bring us to salvation. So we're going to jump in here. Verses 1 through 3, and you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. The examples of these desires of the body and mind are plentiful. I hit on some of them in my own testimony. Galatians 5 has a good list. It says, now the works of the flesh are evident. They are sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Well, how do these kinds of desires affect us? Now, certainly, hopefully, we're not basking in these sinful desires. But how do these desires affect us? There are three different areas I want to look at. How do they affect our thought life, our relationships, and our community? So how do these desires affect our thought life? Well, every sin starts off first in the thoughts of man. James tells us that blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him. And then it says this, let no one say when he is tempted, I'm being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each one is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it is conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. The experiences that we allow ourselves to walk in, the places we allow our mind to go, those are the things that end up luring us into temptation. A different translation says, when our own evil desires. Good desires don't lead us to bad things. It all starts in the mind. Think about the very beginning. Genesis 3. Everything had been made, everything was good. And then we get to Genesis 3. And in Genesis 3, the devil shows up and he questions Eve. And he's questioning her about God's intent for his image bearers. The temptation to determine for herself what was good became a delight to her eyes. That forbidden fruit was a delight to her eyes. And for me, my fall is often found in going back to that idol of the fear of man. That you'll remember my story. I started to love the things of this world and care more about what people said and what they thought than what God said. And that's a temptation for me to slip back into. The temptation that I find myself almost acting like I'm ashamed of Christ. And sometimes I even remain silent when I know I should speak up. And this is me reverting back to that idolatry of letting someone else or something else determine who I am. When sinful desires affect this area, it often hurts other people, but makes you feel like you are the victim. The deceitful effects of the thought life creates lies and unbelief and wrong belief that cloud your mind and you stop agreeing with God. Well, how do these sinful desires affect our relationships? Again, we'll go to James. James 4 says, what causes quarrels and what causes fights among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war within you? You desire and you do not have, so you murder. You covet and you cannot obtain, so you fight and you quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and you do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your own passions. Again, I'll look to myself, this fear of man that is my main temptation to go back to. How this affects my relationships is How I'm viewed by others determines my identity, or my judgment about another person determines their identity. Speaking about someone in a dishonorable way, first for me, starts by thinking about someone in a dishonorable way. To protect myself from being hurt, sometimes I keep myself from being fully known. I find myself assuming other people's motives while not assessing my own motives. This is how these evil desires creep in and affect our relationships. When sinful desires affect this area, correction is no longer welcomed. It gets replaced with shame and with pride and with resentment. And then we got this third area of community. How do these desires affect community? Well, Isaiah 5, 20 and 21 says, "Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and shrewd in their own sight." And here's one from Romans. "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. But they became futile in their thinking and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things." I mean, this is practically the story of the Old Testament. Everywhere you read in the Old Testament, it seems like God is calling his people to come back. Right. Come back to me. I love you. I've chosen you. And these people are not looking up, but they're looking around and saying, we want to be like everybody else. And our communities get destroyed. The prophetic voices are the ones that call God's people back to right relationship with God. And when I'm afraid to repent because I want to live in this kind of deceitful desires, or if I don't want to change, then I want to run from God and not to him. And if I'm not listening to him, I'm not going to be one of those prophetic voices calling people to come back. When the fear of man trumps the fear of God, the values of the kingdom take second seat to the values of the world. In verse 4 in Ephesians 2, But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And he raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace, of kindness toward us in Christ. Thank you, Lord, for the gospel, right? The gospel is the good news of what God has done through the life, death, resurrection, ascension of Jesus. God created all things, visible and invisible. I was meeting with the consistory last week, and I told them about this walk that I went on. And I'm not going to tell you where it is. It's somewhere in Linden, and I call it the Big Tree Walk, because near the end of the walk, there's this tree. It's a cottonwood tree. It's 8 feet in diameter. And so I Googled, how do you tell how old this tree is, and found this website where you put in the species of the tree, the circumference of the tree, so I had to do some math. And this tree, according to this website, started growing 368 years ago. So I started thinking, that's 300 years before this church was planted. That tree was grown. Before the name of Jesus was spoken in this part of the world, in this part of America, God gave that tree life. Before any of your ancestors came to America, God told that tree to grow. Because before America was a nation, that tree was growing. And I was just so struck and so in awe that here I am, I feel like I'm old, I'm 42. And me and that tree have something in common. Not one day goes by where we are not relying on God to say, you can be alive today. Nothing lives, nothing thrives apart from God allowing it. God created all things. That tree, me, you, but also everything invisible. The angels, the demons, the principalities, all things were created by him and for him. He created us for his glory, and we should live for his glory. But then all of us have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. The Bible says that's why we deserve eternal punishment. That's why death is coming, because of sin. The wages of sin is death, and all of us are going to die because of sin. Yet in his great mercy, God sent his only son, Jesus, into the world to provide for sinners the way of eternal life. And this is a free gift to all who trust in Jesus as Lord and Savior. For the believer, your salvation is as secure as Christ is. And this passage tells us where he is, seated in the heavenly places. Gospel that this passage is presenting us is the good news of our past salvation. Do you see all these past tense happening in this passage? When Christ willingly went to the cross and died, the wrath of Almighty God toward our sin was satisfied. There's that line in the song, "For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live." This passage says that he made us alive. That's past tense. You've been made alive in Christ. You have been saved, past tense. He has raised us up, past tense. He has seated us, past tense. The gospel is good news for our past sins. They are forgiven and remembered no more. Colossians 2, 13 and 14 says, God made us alive together with him, having forgiven us all of our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with his legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. Now, the gospel is also the good news of our present salvation. Right here, right now. 1 Corinthians 1:18 says, "For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." This word means the present salvation, the ongoing salvation. The Holy Spirit is doing something in me and in you right now. Do you believe that? He quickens our spirits to turn towards him. It's his kindness working in us that leads us to repentance. And it's by his Spirit in us that we can even know him and bless him. If God's Spirit was not living inside of us right now, we would be cursing his name. What stops us? God's Spirit, God's present gospel working in us. Now, the gospel is also the good news of a future salvation in the coming ages, this passage says. In 2 Corinthians, it says it this way, "For in this tent we groan, longing to put on our heavenly, bodies, if indeed by putting it on we may not be found naked. For while we are still in this tent, we groan, being burdened, not that we would be unclothed, but that we would be further clothed, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. He who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has given us the Spirit as a guarantee." There's still something coming. When the gospel changes your life, you become a child of the kingdom. And that's not a kingdom that starts when you get buried. That's a kingdom that starts when you come to Him. It's here. It's now. And it's still to come. There's still something coming, and it has been assured by the sacrifice of the Son of God, and it's for those who are in Him. There's this other line of the song that I'll sing. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Some of you before me, I think. But that's our hope, right? That this isn't it. That we haven't been saved just for this. Then we get to the end of this passage. "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing, it's the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good work, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." We are His workmanship. We are His masterpiece. God is truly an artist. I've told myself, every time I go on that walk, I will stop and be in awe at the size of that tree. What kind of creator made that? I've also told myself that in the fall, when those trumpeter swans come, every time they fly over me, as long as it's safe, I will stop and look. Did you know that that's the third heaviest flying bird in the world? Trumpeter swan. It's amazing. Guys, be amazed. Yeah, wow. God is an artist. And then He made you. The crowning creation. Made in the image of God. You guys are amazing. The way that you reflect the Creator of the world. Wow. Faith is not your own doing. I think this is what God has brought me here to tell you. Faith is a gift from God. And pun intended, right? Faith is a gift from God. Grace is expressed in God's actions of extending mercy and loving kindness and salvation to sinners. We see grace, we see faith at work. You know, church membership, baptism, confirmation, communion, being generous, being a good neighbor, have no power to bring salvation. The only thing that we can do that will have any part in salvation is to exercise faith in what Jesus Christ has done for us. If you are in Christ, you don't need to be saved again. I'm not here to get you saved again, but you need to be reminded again of the continuing work of grace. As we've looked at this passage, has the Lord brought an area to mind where you have been battling to believe the right things? Are you in agreement with who God says you are? You are His workmanship, His masterpiece, His fine artwork, created in His image, fearfully and wonderfully made, delighted in, loved, and chosen, and created for good works. I started with my story because I keep going back to that fall part of my story. Starting to believe again that maybe someone else's voice should have more weight in my life than I need to give it. I've heard someone say that the gospel is not the, what is it? Oh boy. If you say a quote, you got to get it right. The gospel is not just what saves us. It's what's going to get us to the end. It's the A to Z. We can never tire of hearing what Jesus has done for us on the cross. Because every time we start to slip into that unbelief or wrong belief, we need to get brought back to who is God, what has he done, and how do I need to live in light of that? Any fly fishermen here? Okay, well, I'm a fly fisherman. And so as such, my favorite movie and book is A River Runs Through It. It's not really my favorite book. My favorite book is Count of Monte Cristo. That has nothing to do with the sermon. But A River Runs Through It, if you're a fly fisherman, you better have watched that. And in this book and movie, the author, Norman MacLean, he says, "My father was very sure about certain matters pertaining to the universe. To him, all things good, trout as well as eternal salvation, come by grace, and grace comes by art, and art does not come easy." And what he's reflecting on is this end of this passage. We are his workmanship. And we're not saved by works, but because of who he is and who he created us to be, we get to do works. We rest in that past good news that our sins have been forgiven. We live in that current good news that the Holy Spirit has been given to us as a deposit, and one day we are going to be changed. And we look forward to that future gospel hope of eternal life with Jesus. And it all happens through grace. Titus 2 says, Paul is instructing young believers on the island of Crete. He says, "For the grace of God has appeared with salvation for all people, instructing us to deny godlessness and worldly lusts, and to live in a sensible, righteous, and godly way in the present age while we wait for the blessed hope and appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ." Another one, 2 Corinthians 12:9. Paul says that the Lord taught him that my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is perfected in weakness. Then 2 Peter 3:18, Peter concludes his second letter with these words, "But grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ." My hope as we leave here and reflect on this passage is that you would be picturing your own story. How has God revealed himself to you? Have you been amazed at a big tree or a big bird? Have you seen his handiwork display who he is? Have you seen his power to overcome your resistance as you pursue unbelief and wrong belief? Have you rested from your attempt to gain his favor by your good works? That's what the gospel is inviting us to. Receive this free gift of grace that's offered through Jesus Christ. Let's pray. God, thank you for being the hero of my story. Thank you, God, for being the hero of your story. God, thank you for not giving up on any of us. There's nothing that we have done or that we can do that would surprise you, that would turn you away. You are faithful. Your steadfast love never changes. Your mercies are new every morning. God, I pray for the youngest person in this room to the oldest person in this room to reflect on the gospel message, to find hope in the gospel message. And this week, God, as the cares of the world and the weight of the world and the cares of life and come crashing in, help us agree with what God says about who we are and what Jesus has done. And help us lay hold again on the blood of Jesus, on his body that was broken for us, his blood that was shed for us. Thank you for this great salvation. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness, so
Among all those who are sanctified. Go in God's grace. Amen.